Egads. This is the last Sunday that we are dealing with the Sermon on the Mount. And we've dealt with it all of February, or have been reading about it all through February. And we get down to this place, and it really does hook very closely, in my mind, to the Leviticus reading, which is the holiness code. The last line of which, this is a nicer line to start with, "But you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." That's the second half of, this is your quiz. It's the second half of the great commandment. I am the Lord your God. You shall have no other gods before you. Right? That's the second half. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. It's a tremendous undertaking to think about loving all of our neighbors. And our neighbors far and our neighbors near. But sometimes even this person sitting next to you, maybe sharing your bed, occasionally it's difficult to even think about loving them. And I was thinking about, as we look at these readings and contemplate love, which I think in a sense is what the whole Sermon on the Mount is about trying to get to that sense of love, I think about what it is that holds us back from loving. What keeps us from loving? And sometimes the most immediate thing is, you offended me, so I don't feel a whole lot of love toward you. Either, you know, you said, I liked what you wore last week, which means you don't like what I wore this week, or something, you know, much more terrible than that. It keeps us from loving because we've just got these little feelings, these little things that keep us from loving in the most immediate way. The other thing that keeps us from loving sometimes is that we have been brought up from a very young age to not appreciate whole segments of our society, maybe. And I think in my own life, I think it would be accurate, there's maybe a few different kinds of people that I was taught not to appreciate very much. The biggest group maybe is lazy people. People who don't put an effort into trying things. And I think I also was taught to not appreciate very much people who thought a whole lot about their makeup and clothes. So you know, in your own upbringing, and maybe there's some more profound people. My own family, I think my grandfather in particular was a fairly bigoted guy. I didn't have enough direct contact with him that the only thing that I knew was that was wrong because my mother said that was wrong. But, you know, how she came to that, having been raised by him, is kind of interesting too. But his view really was that generous view where, you know, it was nice that black people were doing so well on TV. The Archie Bunker line. Yeah. So sometimes it's the way we're raised that keeps us from loving other people. And then there's another thing I think that keeps us from loving, and that's that we are afraid if we put our love out there that it will not be received. And that fear, if you will, of not having somebody else accept the love we're trying to give to them, I think keeps us from ever even trying to reach out to other people. Especially people that we may be a little bit afraid of for whatever reason. But I think the other thing that keeps us from loving other people too is, my word for it is mean-spiritedness. I just don't want to. I'm sorry, I can't. And, you know, and that holding to that place, I can't change. I won't change. I refuse to. It's not worth it. However you want to put it. And we just, our own sort of doggedness in keeping to our enemies are our enemies and they will be our enemies forever. I think about, in my own life, the years quite frankly, that it took after Mylan and I went to court about custody of his mother with Alzheimer's, the kind of feelings, this horrible gut feelings I had about his stepfather was really, I mean, it kept me from ever feeling anything sympathetic towards him at all. But it was my own holding on to that that kept me from seeing anything, any redeeming thing about the guy for a while, even though I had been friends with him before that. I would say, you know, sidebar to that, I think when you take things to court, that happens. It's not usually the best way to solve problems in a loving way. But I think behind all of these things is possibly fear. Maybe, in a sense, it's the fear of our whole society's fear of certain types of people. It's our own fear of being hurt or rejected, our own fear that we won't be appreciated. But then what's the other side of that? What keeps us from receiving the love that's being given to us? What keeps you from receiving the love that's being given to you? I think that there's as many things that keep us from receiving love as there are that keep us from giving love. I don't always receive the love that I'm given, you know, so you say, I love the way you do such and such. Oh, no, not really. You know, it's sort of a false sense of inferiority. We also don't receive love sometimes because we don't value the person giving the love. I really don't care whether you love me or not because I don't care about you. And sometimes I think we don't receive the love because we don't have experience of receiving love. I think there's people, I think possibly everybody sitting here today has met somebody who's just so, has had such a hard life that receiving love is just about impossible to imagine. Just this past week, we finally watched the movie Precious. Have you seen Precious? How that girl, who grew up in this horrendous situation, how that girl ever learned to receive love is almost unimaginable. I don't know, you know, how she did it. But we could completely understand why she would never know how to receive love. Because of the kind of downtrodden situation she grew up in. But thinking about that be perfect, I went back to Carol's sermon a couple of weeks ago, and she said about the be the salt, you are the salt of the earth, right, Carol? You are the light of the world, and wanted to make sure that we understood that it's not you will be the light of the world, you will be the salt of the earth, but you are right now. So go back to that be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. And I was thinking about that and going, so that's also not future, become perfect, but it's not quite the same as are, it's more like a command. It's more like a command, and I don't know enough Greek, I mean, I looked it up and tried to figure out, but it doesn't help me much. Be perfect. Where's the source of our perfection? What's the source of our perfection? That's the second half of it. God is the source of our perfection. And for those of us who suffer from perfectionism, a command like this seems like I just need to try harder to be perfect. If I just try harder to be perfect, so at the end of the day, I'll take up that tally and say, well, I did this right, I did that right, you know, and so I'm going to improve. Problem with putting that completely to the side is I don't think it is completely to the side. I think this is that kind of command that tells us to actually look at your life a little bit and see where you're off the mark, if you will. To acknowledge where we don't love our neighbor as ourselves. To acknowledge that we cannot yet love our enemies the way that we are commanded to love our enemies. To see where it is that we're standing outside of that perfection of God and trying to trim those places off. But that also hooks into my perfectionism. So I'm in this hole right now, aren't I? And it's hard to get out of that hole, except always to offer our imperfections to God. Number one. Number two, acknowledge that you're human and you are never going to actually be totally perfect in that perfectionistic kind of way. But rather, you are perfect in the eyes of God. You are perfect in the eyes of God. But so is your enemy. So is the person you hate. So is the person you do not trust, is perfect in the eyes of God. And then that perfection starts to look entirely different. I am perfect in the eyes of God. So is my most hated enemy. So is the guy who is sitting on death row because he raped and beat and killed a young woman. He is perfect in the eyes of God. I'm supposed to love him too, and love that perfectness in him. And that begins our journey in faith, our journey to love our neighbor as ourselves. You are perfect in the eyes of God. Your enemy is perfect in the love of God. Love your enemy. Love your neighbor.
Amen. Amen.